for RCTV Live, and you can view it on Comcast Channel 32 or Verizon Channel 99. Videographer tonight is Alexander, and check www.rctv.org for more information and replay times. And first on the agenda is an Eagle Scout project. And Mr. Adam Clark is here to make his presentation.
Placed in three different locations, generally on these causeways, these paths or driving routes, as you can see here. They're going to be put like off to the side or at where they open on each end, so that because it's like an open area and there's a nearby water source for the bats, I went to the locations and they're approximately 15 to 20 feet from the water. So where these will be these will be installed. They're going to be installed on galvanized poles there, but they're going to be on dry land. I made sure of that. So there's no threat of flooding. And another reason I chose this project is because bats, I think, are very helpful to a community. They eat mosquitoes in mass numbers. Each individual bat can eat like over 1,000, 1,200 mosquitoes a night. Of course, this helps people because mosquitoes can be a horrible nuisance and thing to deal with in the spring and summer, so having these bats around will benefit people who use the town forest for recreation, anyone walking by, especially dog walkers. And I did a lot of research on what goes into the construction of each box to make them successful. So each one, I plan on painting a darker brown to match like the environment, like a wooded kind of environment, and that absorbs heat, which is a preferred environment of that. And as far as how they're being posted up, they're going to be posted on galvanized poles, which screw into each other. I can get two, or like each one is going to be in two pieces that are 10 feet long, and they can screw together to make one piece. So each pole will add up to be 20 feet long. I plan on using an auger to dig 4 feet into the ground, so in total are going to be 16 feet in the air, which is appropriate because recommended height for these is 12 to 20 feet, so 16 feet is a good like middle ground for a height. And to stabilize the pole so that they're in the ground, I researched a lot about an eco-friendly cement, and I did in fact find a cement called Green Mix from Home Depot that is environmentally friendly and is not on the environment. So I'm open to any suggestions or pieces of advice.
How high off the ground are these sat boxes?
They're going to be 16 feet off of the ground.
And as you place them, have you considered placing them in a southern exposure?
Yes, I did research that. The areas that they're in do receive sunlight, so where they are at 16 feet, I measured around the area, they will they won't be blocked by trees, so they will receive an adequate amount of sunlight to make them a good warm environment for the
bats. Do you know where the closest hibernacular is?
I do not look into that. Just in case.
There isn't anything in the town forest that you know has a high vernacular, right?
Not that I know, but.
Okay.
Um.
Are these specific to certain species of bats, like little brown?
Yeah, I researched and what I found, the little brown bat or the big brown bat, the two different species, those seem to be the most common in North America and especially in this area, so I figured those would be the species nesting in here, but you know, the construction that I'm making them, any local bat species will be able to nest in them.
Adam, I have a couple of questions. Why don't you just hang them on trees?
I was originally going to do that, but then I found out that bats are more vulnerable to predators that way.
Okay.
Like birds of prey, owls, hawks, and especially raccoons. So trees are not an ideal spot. It has been done by many people in the past, but from the research I found, I forget the name, it was an organization called Fly By Night in Florida. They said poles is a more ideal place to put them.
Sounds like a good idea. And the only other question I had is you said you're going to paint them, and I was wondering if it'd be better just leave the cedar natural. Did you think about that?
I did, but in this area in New England, it is, you know, it's not the warmest weather, as we all know. So I think painting them dark is a better idea to, you know, absorb more heat and create a better environment. And I did look into the paint. There's this like latex paint that is good and will not create a smell that will drive away the bats.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions from the commission? Are there any questions from the community?
Thank you, Adam. Looks like you've done your research.
Yeah.
I make
good
a
good job. Present. Good job on your presentation.
I make a motion to approve. This is an NOI.
Second.
It's
not a notice.
An existing NOI. Just make a motion to
approve the project.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you very much, and I think you did a great job in your research.
Yeah, thank you very much.
And good luck in your future wildlife endeavors.
thank you very much. I appreciate it.
We have a few minutes. Do we have enough time to... No, we have a couple of minutes. Yes, we do. The order of conditions for Randall Road. Did you?
I didn't have a chance to.
Harry caught a few typos, but other than that, I think it was okay.
Okay.
Dave, did you have an opportunity to look at the order of conditions for Randall? Did you get a copy?
No.
I didn't get a copy.
I didn't either.
Well, he came today.
I didn't get a copy. Yeah. He sent it to somebody else.
No.
Emailed it.
Yeah, I didn't.
We're going to bring Adam back in a few minutes. I don't know if you're ready now or in a few minutes.
Yeah.
Right now? Yeah, something. You'd like to ask the commission?
Yeah, just a. I'll be very brief. Of course, I'd like to request a donation if convenient requires here. The Town Forest Commission is my beneficiary, but I'm welcome. I'm open to any donations.
You ask it for money or mosquitoes?
I noticed you got the vote first. You guys.
that was slick.
You found me running for office.
Is that your dad sitting back there?
No, that's my mentor.
Oh, smooth.
Yeah.
So we do have a fund for such monies. So you know, no amount was talked about, but I don't know what's the total project.
The total cost, I believe, is $1,036.
36.
Of course, I'm not asking for that, just, you know, nothing major.
Would it be
What's that?
How do you make a donation?
Well,
we have
a fund that we're in charge of, and we can use some money to fund things like this. We've funded benches and material for other projects in the past.
Will the donation to that fund go specifically to Adam's project, or will it go to?
This will go specifically to Adam's project.
What's been the protocol in the past as far as percentage of the project and amount?
Well, usually there's an amount asked for. I would be, with the money what we have, I think 200, 250 would be where we would be.
I was going to suggest 10 to 20% of the project cost as what our donation would be.
Which is 200.
Right, which is $200.
Sure, well, it's up to you, then.
I would be okay with that.
Yeah. All right, do I have a motion?
I make a motion to fund Adam's project, the Bat House project in the town forest, for his Eagle Scout project, in the amount of $200 from the Conservation Commission.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
All those in favor? Okay, so when would he be able to get those funds? Do you have any idea?
Let me look into it, and I'll contact you.
What's your timing on this project?
I plan on starting this project in early to mid-March.
Okay. So we have some time.
Yeah. Yeah, right.
Okay. Great. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right. It's after 7:10, and we have a notice of intent 270-0678, Simon's Way Reading Rifle and Revolver Club, which is a notice of intent. And the public hearing is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Chapter 131, Section 40, and as amended in the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1, hearing is conducted in the following manner. Applicant presents proposal. Commission will receive reports from administrator, any advisors, to other town departments. Commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and then the public will be given the opportunity to ask questions, which should be directed to the chair. Has everybody signed in an attendance sheet? In the back, okay. At this time, I'd like to introduce members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my left.
Chuck Tarone, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Anika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Al Couliard.
David Pinnett.
Okay.
Rebecca, I just need to do the thing about the...
The what?
The conflict of interest.
Okay, certainly.
Even though, as members of the Conservation Commission, we are volunteer members, we are considered employees of the town. And as considered an employee of the town, there are certain rules required by the State Ethics Commission to be followed and abided. So back in the fall, knowing that this was coming up, I contacted the State Ethics Commission and spoke with one of the staff attorneys, Attorney Duca, about this proposal coming up, because I am a member of Reading Rifle and Revolver Club. And as such, she suggested that I actually file under Chapter 268A, a subsection 23B3 form, which I did. I filled out and I filed it with the town clerk of Reading as such, because in my capacity as a municipal employee, I'm expected to take certain actions in the performance of my duties as a member of the Conservation Commission. And one may assume or infer from my actions here that I might garner favor from the petitioner, or I may be in favor of them. So I did file the paper stating that I was a member of Reading Rifle and Revolver, and filled out the form, filed it with the proper authorities, and taking into account the situation that we find ourselves in, I don't have anything to do with actual administration of this project at the club itself. So I'm not in the decision-making process part of that project, and as such, I feel it was appropriate, as did the staff attorney, to notify of my potential conflict of interest and file the proper form. So that being the case, I'm going to call that, and I feel that I can perform my duties as a member of the Reading Conservation Commission objectively and fairly with the petitioner that's coming before us at, from the Reading Rifle and Revolver.
Thank you, Dave.
Good evening. I'm Mark Slater from Allen Engineering here on behalf of Reading Rifle and Revolver. For those of you who aren't familiar with the club, it's a private nonprofit organization. It's located on the road that extends past Burbank Arena off of April Street. The site, the entire site is a little over 53 acres. The club has been in operation for many years. And along with the private membership of the club is also available to use for use by several law enforcement agencies, state, federal, and local, for training purposes. What we're proposing tonight is the construction of a new range directly behind the existing clubhouse. We have an existing range here that is used for both rifle and pistol. The firing line, target stands are at 100 feet, 100 yards rather, 50 yards, and then we've got some shorter targets over here for the pistols. The proposed range is in this location. The total size of the range is approximately 7,000, 8,000 square feet, of which a portion of it, about a third of it, is already within an existing range. The white area here is an existing range. There's a target stand here for 50 yards, shooting stands right in here. So there's a portion of the range that's actually going to be converted into the new range. The new range is going to be primarily for training. It's going to have enhanced safety features, which include a 9-foot-tall wall on each side, and I'll go into the details of the wall in a few minutes. And it's also going to have some overhead deflectors and a sand berm for the final impact area. And the goal of all of these features is so that when you're standing on the firing line, you don't see any sky at all, so there's not going to be the possibility of errant bullets flying beyond the limits of the range itself. One of the other features that we're trying to, we're proposing is the installation of another 9-foot wall down the center of the existing range. And what that would do is open up the uses for these so we could have two distinct uses ongoing at the same time. Currently, what's going on here is we might have some pistol shooters down in this location and then some rifle shooters down here shooting at 100 yards. So if these guys have to change their target, these guys have to cease fire. So if we put a barrier down the middle, these guys can keep shooting while these shooters over here can do what they need to do, and vice versa. And the third component of the project is to install an additional berm along here. It's actually a wall, a sand-filled wall, right along here. The reason being, there's an existing path or roadway that goes down to another target stand down in the back, and this is the target stand for the long range rifle range. That's the 200, 300, 500, and 600 yard ranges. And this is a fairly active roadway during the shooting season, the match season. So we're just going to propose a little bit more safety enhancement by providing a barrier here, because it's for some of the members who walked the road this past Saturday, it is somewhat unnerving walking back here and then seeing shooters shooting off into this direction. So we're putting a 9-foot wall along here. This was something that was also recommended by the insurance company for the club as well, to just bring it up to more current standards. And Chuck, if you could go into the HESCO presentation.
Oh, sure.
actual 9-foot tall barrier that we'd be building. It's basically a woven geotextile inside a galvanized steel mesh. And basically they, you fill them with sand and they stable and they'll absorb, they're designed to absorb RPGs. So we won't have any issues with what we're shooting at the club. Can you go to the next?
Excuse me, I'm sorry, I'm gonna have to leave temporarily for another meeting.
Okay.
All right, thanks.
What RPGs?
Rocket propelled grenades. These are, this is a military application. So these are designed for security measures in the more hostile areas.
I would assume it's overkill in this situation.
It's absolutely overkill.
They're not using those at this range, right? Correct, they're not using those at this range.
Oh, you should hear them on Saturdays.
Yeah, right.
All hail Saturdays.
Yeah.
I was gonna ask you, what does MIL-19 mean, is that?
That's just the model number.
Okay.
So this is a detail, you can see the spiral hinges, the galvanized wire mesh, and then the geotextile that basically lines the compartments. And you can see that they're broken down into several compartments. The overall length is 10 feet, but they come folded up as an accordion. You can go to the next. So here you can see them being flat on the ground, that's how they're shipped. And they just basically unfold, you stand them up. And if you go to the next slide.
Or the desert.
Just fill them up with dirt with either a backhoe or front end loader or whatever. And then you have the final product. And then you have the final product. This one is just happens to be the 10 feet long, 9 feet tall, 3.5 feet wide, and they've used it for, you know, housing vehicles or whatever. So this is the type of barrier that we'll be constructing on both sides of the range, and also in the middle of the two ranges, and at the far western and eastern end of the range. I mentioned we have overhead deflectors. Basically, they're just steel panels. Some of them come rubber coated to help absorb some of the impact and deflect, help absorb the impact so that you don't get as much deflection. And they're staggered along here with the effect that as you look down, you won't be able to see the sky. So as I'm doing this. The deflectors are going to be in between the targets. In this particular case, there's no intermediate targets, but we would be having a target stand here, another one here, and then one down just in front of the sand impact area. So if you go to the So here you see the deflector shields in the front, but also what we're going to have a concrete pad for the shooting area. We're also going to have a deflector shield and a roof attached to the existing buildings. So again, this is going to help prevent any stray bullets from going up into the air. Just go to the last one. This is actually what you'd be seeing as you'd be shooting. So the targets would be below here, and it gives you the tunnel effect so that you have overall security and safety. And this particular range is going to be have been encouraged by the ATF, Reading Police, some of the other police departments that have expressed an interest in some more enhanced environments for additional training operations.
There's one additional safety thing here that's not shown in this picture, that you don't have the HESCO barriers down either side of that. So that
Correct.
Would be in addition to what
in
you
addition
see
to
here.
The HESCO, yeah. These
right.
are just in the middle of the range.
Right.
So
would
you go to the first one?
Would the ones that you have be supported on footings like that, or would they be hung from HESCO barrier to HESCO barrier? How
no,
would they
they'll be in footings
be
like
in footings?
This.
Okay.
Yeah.
What about
yeah.
those HESCO barriers? There's no are you gonna pour a concrete slab for that?
No.
There has
no,
to be some sort of preparation to
Basically, you just level the ground, you set them in there, and put them right on the ground and fill them up, and that's it. And it's all just sand-filled, so it's not creating any impervious surfaces. The water will just go in, filter through.
They're really flexible, so they're good if you get some settling in one direction or the other, they just go with it.
Structural cracks in them? They're not going to go over?
No, this is a specific catalog.
3 feet wide, 9 feet high?
3.5 feet wide and 9 feet high, and they're 10 feet long, so.
They use them a lot. They've been trying to start using them for like flood control. So they used to stack sandbags when emergency floods. They've been starting to use them for that. They can actually hold back water at the 3 feet wide, you know, to a certain height.
Right. And they also, in some cases, they'll put two rows down the middle and then another one in the middle on top of it. So you could actually build an 18-foot tall wall with no reinforcing or anything. It's just a stable wall. It's pretty effective, and it's especially over in more hostile areas in the Middle East. Sand is pretty plentiful, so it's certainly pretty easy to build.
Can you go back to the range NOI plan?
This one here?
Yeah, that one. So you can see that we have the barriers here and the overhead, target stands here, the overhead deflectors. Right in
do
there.
You want to zoom that? Maybe zoom.
How deep are the footings that you expect for the overheads?
The footings, really they don't need to be, it's more for stability, so maybe a couple feet.
Fine, you can see the dots.
Yeah. So there's, We're not sure of the exact model that we're getting, whether it's and how far apart the supports are going to be. We're hoping to not have more than maybe one or two intermediate posts for obvious reasons. If we could have them with just a post on each end, then it would be obviously a much better scenario. So basically, that's it. We have requested a few waivers for some work within the 25-foot zone here, and also for the HESCO barrier itself, and the retaining wall behind the sand berm being within the 35-foot as permanent structures, along with the HESCO wall over on the other side. There was a narrative in the report going through the justification for that. There really is no place on the entire property for expanding or creating this without abandoning another portion of an active range. So we are abandoning a 50-foot range here, but we're creating a new wider one. The new area is about 5,000 square feet. Of undisturbed area that we'll be clearing. Within that area, there are actually 25 trees that have to come down that are 6 inches or greater. It is fairly densely wooded, but there's only a couple of trees that are actually over 12 inches, so it's fairly new growth, but again, they're 6 to 12 inches and there's 25 of them. One of the other things we're doing is proposing an area between the existing target stand and the back of the wall. It's actually going to be renaturalized. We're just going to let it grow back and become natural buffer zone. You can see the target stand right here is pretty much up against the edge of the wetland. So all of this area from 35 feet into the wetland is going to be allowed to restore itself, and it won't be mowed or maintained like the rest of the range. So we're hoping that would offset the impacts within the 35-foot area here. With respect to the trees, we are aware of the tree policy that's in effect. We're not a single-family home, so we're not technically subject to the $500 maximum. With 25 trees, that comes up to $6,250 or $250 per tree. Which for the amount of area that we clear, and it comes up to $1.25 per square foot, which we look at that as being a little excessive for what we're asking. And given the amount of area on the site that's preserved as wetland as it is, we would ask the commission to come up with a more reasonable consideration for either a donation to the tree fund or allowing us to plant a reduced number of shrubs or trees. We have looked around the site, and we have basically cleared ranges, parking area, a few buildings, and the rest is active range or wetland and buffer zone that's very heavily treed. So we're not really sure where we could put any additional trees. We might be able to put a few back in here, you know, maybe one or two up around the front of the clubhouse or something. But I think, you know, we're limited on space, and I'm certain the town could find better uses where they're more open to the public too. As far as costs, like I said, we're a nonprofit organization. So we're not like a developer or a large corporation that has a lot of money to throw around for trees. Recognizing that we're bigger than a single family home, so we wouldn't be subject to the $500 limit, but we think maybe something in the range of $1,000 might be more suitable, but it's certainly up for suggestions in that regard. And with that, I'll turn it over to the commission for any questions or comments.
We had a site visit the other day on Monday, and I commend you on your photographs, because that really put it into very good perspective. That was well done. Yes, we did see quite a few trees back there. And Dave, did you have you and I talked about that curve.
I had a suggestion. I talked to a couple of the commission members, and when I had this in my packet, and I really didn't see it until I saw the board standing up in front of me on the table, and it just kind of jumped right out at me. There is a variance that's being sought on this project as it is on the right hand side over here for the HESCO barriers, which are inside the 25-foot line, and the existing building already is inside the 35 and 25-foot line as it is, and I just looked at this upper corner, the upper left hand corner where that radius is, and just thought, just from a, maybe it's just my geometric and logical mind, but it just seems to me that it would make more sense to square that off from a construction point and a layout point, and also a stability point to, you know, if you're going to make this improvement and make it where it is, I just didn't think that that was that big of an addition to the variance that's already being sought in the first place. But it would be of benefit to the range as a whole to be able to just square off that radius corner without really any significant impingement to the existing wetland. And one of the other things I also talked about with the conservation members was to, you know, perhaps plant some trees around the two sides of that to mitigate the trees that are being cut down on the reins themselves, possibly a slanted dual row of trees around the left-hand side and the rear side of that, which would not only make, in addition to the wetlands area for, you know, permeable, you know, vegetation, but it also would create a visual barrier and a noise barrier as well, in addition to what's there. So I just wanted to throw that out. It's just a single voice, but it's something that I saw, and I thought with the variances being sought already, it just seemed to make more logical sense to me to throw that out there. I wouldn't be opposed to doing that.
Dave, on the left-hand side, that's pretty heavily wooded and treed. I don't know that you'd be able to really successfully dig into the other root system. Are we talking about the same side?
Yeah,
that's heavily treed and vegetated, so I think it'd be disturbing roots, existing roots. But I thought your idea in the back is not a bad one.
Yeah,
basically extending the HESCO block wall here and then squaring off the
and maybe planting some things, you know, right in back, where you've got that replication sort of area.
Mm-hmm. It's here.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll just be taking this and going straight up here.
Have we ever let a structure inside the 25-foot line? So I would tell you that Dave talked to me also, and I was against this. I didn't allow the applicant to draw it that way. This is a virgin, plus or minus maybe 30-year-old forest in this area. So for 30 years, that's trees and vegetation, and a certain area needs to be habitat. On the other side of the range, you're as close in this wetland area here, but this is an existing range.
Right.
So what I said was, you're able to maintain your existing range, but where there are trees, if you go into the 25-foot, that's kind of an area where we have never, since I've been here, and I don't think when Fran was here, where they allowed construction in this area, at least not just because it looks out of proportion. So I guess my first question is, built this way, does this structure work for what your purposes are?
Yes.
And then I think the other thing would be the fees to do that would be pretty steep just to square off that corner if you got into the 25-foot area.
Mm-hmm. So the fees.
You would be paying, in addition, I just mentioned you didn't want to pay for the trees, and if you squared off that corner, you'd be paying for getting in that close permanent structure within 25 feet. So we would have asking you for more money. It seems to work as it sits now, and our regulations that says there's no work allowed in the 25-foot zone of natural vegetation stays intact.
I would concur with Chuck. I think from the on this right side here, the 9-foot Hesco barrier, I realize how close we're getting, but it's an existing range.
Open.
I also, we were out there, I see the safety concerns. I see that why it would be brought up. So I have very little concerns about this, but on the other side, yeah, I don't think I would want to see this go, we're already looking to approve a variance into the 25-foot zone. I don't think I would want to see this go past the 25-foot structure, go past the 25-foot zone. I guess, and we talked a little bit about this on the site visit, but what is the 10-foot concrete retaining wall look like? Is it?
Oh, in the back, you mean the?
Yeah, on the back side. Does that have, is it like a T-wall? Does it have a footing?
It's a T-wall, so basically you level the area off, and the first course is about 6 inches below grade on some crushed stone. As far as excavating beyond the limits of the wall, very little, a couple inches. You just put it right up against the edge of the excavation with crushed stone. It's a 5-inch thick face, and it's got a concrete T extension, so it's a one unit thing.
Mm-hmm.
They have them either U-shaped or T-shaped or whatever, and they're just stackable. And the soil behind it actually holds it up with the T.
Okay, so it's a T back. So
correct. It's either a T back or a U back, depending on brand we get.
I know what you're. I can't think of what they're called, but I know what you're talking about now.
Right.
Okay. So it's really like a facing rather than a, when I think of a concrete retaining wall, I think of something that's excavated into the ground, buried a certain amount of feet,
footing,
and concrete.
4 feet, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. No, this is just it's something to hold the backside of the sand berm,
yeah,
as opposed to sloping the berm. If we had to slope it, then that would shift everything another probably 15 or 20 feet towards the building.
Okay.
The base would be 30 feet.
MassDOT uses those, that same, there's a couple different manufacturers, but that same T-type thing for highway walls.
I have a question. How long do what's the expected life of the Hesco barrier fabric?
Well, first of all, they were made for fire bases, military bases and forward units, and they were made to be numerous impacts, my rifle and even rocket propelled grenade, which in the old world was a bazooka. Bazookas after a while will blow them out, but nobody's to be shooting into these. So they don't just.
No, just where in terms of, you know, for sitting in the sun, do they biodegrade?
Yeah, UV. They usually have a UV issue.
No, they're UV resistant, and the mesh around it is galvanized.
Yeah, so without being blown up, how long do they last?
Oh, I don't know, 30, 50 years. Yeah, and the fabric itself is replaceable. They do disassemble in sections. You just take the inside out, so you could disassemble like the inside wall, pull the sand out, replace the fabric, and then fill it back up. It's a time-consuming process, but it won't involve going beyond the limit of the existing wall.
I've never seen one taken apart.
So,
yeah, that was my my fear is when 50 years from now, when it breaks down, how does all that sand stay on the interior side of this range and not spill out into the wetland area with that 25 foot?
Well, we would recognize the deterioration early on, and the deterioration we suspect would be, or we anticipate would be, basically on the inside wall from stray shots. There wouldn't be anything affecting the outside, although we would monitor it and, you know, walk around it periodically to see if there's anything going on or any sand leaking out from the bottom or whatever. But again, it would be a process, and if we could go back to the Heskill presentation one. Hold it right there. Oh, right here is good. The spiral hinge corners, these actually screw out. So you could take these spiral hinges out, and that will open up these chain link sections and the fabric as well. So the fabric and the corners of the chain link are actually held together by this spiral hinge. So they could be disassembled on this side slowly and let the fill come out and scoop it out with a backhoe, and then replace the fabric as needed.
Is there an operation and maintenance plan with these, or?
I haven't researched it thoroughly yet as far as operation and maintenance. I did go through the installation procedures. I know they have repair kits for them as well. So if you have some minor holes, you can get some patches, just kind of like a rubber tube. You can get a patch kit for it. With some fairly
almost
strong
seems like you monitor it the way you monitor your roof of your house. You kind of know when it's done, right?
Yeah, I mean, this is, you'll be able to see it. Yeah, and if with the patching system that they have available, we could patch it and prolong the life as needed. And then who knows, in 50 years, they might have something even better and easier to work with.
So that's machinery, right? Is there a way to get machinery in here with how you've set this up?
No, we would have to take something apart.
But
well, we could probably get in there with a bobcat
from,
or something.
Yeah, you probably could work from the open range side, right? And,
yeah,
and then
we wouldn't
in.
Have to go to the wetland side of this
at
all.
So in that same line, when I've seen these assembled, you know, usually when I've seen these, you've been for something like flood control or for base situation. You know, usually they're in a rush. They're trying to get it done quickly. One of the things I want to make sure when this is constructed, you know, it's supposed to go in the bin, and, you know, what you end up with is somebody with a front loader that's just, let's throw as much as we can in there, and you end up with a pile on both sides of the bin. If, you know, this is constructed, I want to make sure that there's care taken, that we're not ending up with a whole bunch of debris on the backside, a whole bunch of extra sand that's just building up on the backside that we're actually getting into the
right.
Now again, those are in locations where sand is plentiful, but
and
when you're paying for it, sometimes it's a little bit different. But again, it's just something I want to make sure.
We're not in a hurry to get it done. Once we start, we're going to work slowly, methodically, carefully. We're not under the gun, so to speak.
Yep.
For constraints or anything.
Okay. Are there any other questions from the commission? Are there any questions from the community? So I guess it's a couple things here. Are we in favor as a group I'd like to take a, I guess, a straw poll about the squaring off of the backside or not.
Is that a request from the applicant?
No, it was a suggestion from the commission member. I mean, the range works without the squaring off. I mean, that's what I heard.
It would be easier to build and save us money and time to build it as suggested, but we could certainly build it like this as proposed.
I'm not in favor of going any further in. I think we typically don't allow that type of structure to go inside the 20-foot, 5-foot.
Mm-hmm.
If this can be built without that being done, I think I would like to see that.
I'm not so worried about setting precedent. I think every case should be on its own merit. Every applicant should be on its own merit. But, you know, if it's not, you know, really a vital part of the project and the project works without it, I don't see any need to, to consider it.
Okay. So I will concur with you folks. And so we won't be squaring off that piece of the project. Now the other item on the table is the reduction in the fee for the replacement trees under our tree replacement policy. And I think we have flexibility as a commission. I think that, what was it, $6,000?
$6,500. Yeah, you don't have the capacity to take care of landscaping at the range. Is that what you're saying, or is there some?
We're trying to figure out where we could plant additional trees that actually make sense and would serve a purpose.
True.
And basically, we have cleared ranges and.
Generally, we have a plant board plan, don't we?
Well, normally, yeah, but I can't figure out where we would put additional trees because we have areas that are being used or woods, so.
Therefore, we have the option. To get a donation to the tree replacement fund.
No, yeah.
So maybe we want to.
There can be a combination of the two.
There could be a combination.
That's what I was thinking. How many?
Do we have
I mean, you're going to save money if you replace some trees.
We don't. We only heard about this about 2 days ago, so we haven't actually investigated where to put them.
Yeah.
Well, we have a website.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we just went on.
Yeah.
We should know.
So.
Apparently, the building was this fall.
One of my, I guess not necessarily concerns, but I like that there's this area behind the back that is currently ranged that is going to be restored. One of my concerns would be, it's not a huge area.
Yeah,
one of my
square feet might be.
Yeah, it's 1,000 square feet. It says right on there. So, is that this area all of a sudden gets used sometime in the future for storage or for? I would like to see this, not necessarily. I think there was a conversation about restoring this to wetland, and I think we was agreed on in the.
But you'd have to dig it down.
Yeah, and I don't think that's what we want to see. But right now, it's outside of part of it's outside of the 25-foot. I would like to see no activity go there. I'd like to maintain that this area is essentially given back for what's being taken away. So, I would propose that this area is a good area for at least some planting. It doesn't need to be a full replacement of what's being taken away, but I guess
things and maybe a post and rail fence on the side that could possibly doesn't look like the right side, left side would get access, but that right side looks like there's quite a bit of activity.
Yeah, where the gravel road
post
is.
Post and rail fence with a couple of our blue signs and some plantings in there.
I think that in essence protects this area from it's essentially being given as replacement for what's being taken away. That would protect that from being used in the future.
That's a good idea.
I don't know what you can fit in there. I don't know how many trees would fit, but it would at least take away from that number. I would be open to considering a lower number. The number proposed sounded low to me, but I think, based on what you could potentially get in there, and what's left, I think there's a number in between there that I would potentially be.
It's something like the size of this room, right? It's about 30 by 30?
Yeah.
Well, it says it's 37 long and I don't know how wide. 30 wide.
So something in the, so you could.
It's a little under 1,100 square feet.
So you could probably fit, what, I don't know, 10 trees in there?
You can also.
They don't have to be trees.
They can be shrubs.
They can be shrubs.
If you have an issue with height of trees.
Rather than a fence, if it's a shrub, you know, some sort of shrubbery right along that line there, I think is all good to protect that area.
So I think that's a good idea, and then as far as, you know, my receptivity to reducing the fee, I think where the club is a not-for-profit, and it's got a public service component with helping the public safety officials better their skills and all of that, I think it's in the public interest to make it affordable, so I'm comfortable giving back a good chunk of that.
Yeah.
So a couple trees and a reduced fee, but are we gonna try and approve this tonight, or?
I think that it was suggested that they can think this over. I personally have some requests, so I'm not sure we're ready to, you know, this might be extended to receive these requests. I had a couple things that I wanted to ask for and to have in place.
So what are those?
So I wanted a plan put together that when you take apart this, even though it's many years in the future, just to have a plan on paper that how that would be done. And then the operation and maintenance plan, I wanted to make sure that the building inspector didn't need to be part of this, so to make sure that you could check out with him. I wanted to know where the sand's being stockpiled and if it's clean sand that you're getting. And then the planting, I think that that's a good suggestion there. You could do some shrubs. We allow shrubs, so they would be pretty low, and it's 2-to-1 for those.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't have to fill that whole area up. I don't like the fence, the wooden fence, because I think there may be ricochets or things like that, so I don't think anyone really walks out there unless they're getting their target, you know, for any other reason. So it wouldn't have a lot of activity. And the other spot that I thought of, first off, we have a plan of this entire complex, but just in front of the building itself is an opportunity to landscape and plant. So I didn't know, that's why I asked you if it's just something you didn't want to get into, because you could just put some shrubs in front of the main house there.
I suppose we could do that. If you pan down that restoration area.
Yeah.
I just want to point out.
Yeah, there it is.
This is on the north side of a 10-foot tall wall, so there would be concern about the amount of sunlight that would be getting through. Obviously, up in this area, but we can't go too close to the wall with low-growing vegetation because there would be a lack of sunlight there.
That's the north side?
Yeah, this is the north side of the wall.
So you could just
we could certainly get some
more
shade. Or less
to north. There are a lot of vegetation species that
shade
grow in shady areas vis-a-vis wetlands.
Mm-hmm.
So I wouldn't worry too much about the lack of sunlight there.
All right.
You could put wetland type of shrubs that actually sometimes can grow in upland situations like winterberry or some other things.
Mm-hmm.
And
okay.
I think you'd be fine with that.
Right.
I wouldn't worry about that
okay.
so much.
I think Al mentioned, are we going to hash this out tonight? You know, maybe
but
not.
I think there are. You've got quite a few things that actually need a little bit more investigation, like the operations and maintenance plan. And I do like the idea of, at the end of its life cycle, how do you dismantle that?
It wouldn't kill us to get a little more information on those footings too. What exactly, how many, size, how deep. I mean, I think maybe you just want to use Bigfoots there, 4-foot Bigfoots, and easy to install, but we should probably know how many, what size, where, how
mm-hmm.
they're going to be built, if they're going to be built on site, if they're going to be precast, whatever the situation is.
Okay.
Maybe a detail of impact wall, is that what you're asking for?
Yeah.
The T wall in the back?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so do I have a motion to continue?
Sure, I'll make a motion to continue, proof of intent 270-0678.
I'll second.
Those in favor? Would you have the information by the next meeting, which?
The 25th.
Yeah, when do they need the information in? By?
Just the week before, week before. I mean,
Before the 25th.
Yeah, want me to look it up?
Next week would be the.
It's next Wednesday.
Cutting a little tight, let's go to the.
You could go to the first meeting in February?
Yeah, that would be a little bit safer.
That's on the 8th.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Thanks, guys.
I mean, so one thing I would suggest, and we've done this before, is if you happen to get it, we can still get you on. If you can't get, you know, we can always just continue at the next meeting.
Okay.
Great, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, 7:20.
I have a family event I gotta get to.
Okay, thanks, Dave.
Hi, Dave.
Notice of intent, 270-06.
The thing I was gonna ask is, when we're done, can I get a copy of all that?
Jack, are you here for 116 Van Norden? Okay.
I gotta go.
Yeah, you wanted to call me.
I gotta go to the bathroom.
This is 116 Van Norden, map 39, lot 72, Dana. And public meeting is being reopened and conducted concurrently under the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Law 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Applicant will make presentation. Commission will receive reports. Commission will address questions to the applicant, and then the public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which is directed to the chair. I'm going to introduce members of the commission, starting on my right. Al.
Al Couillard.
Harry Curtis.
Rebecca Longley, chair.
Michael Flynn.
Chuck.
Chuck Tironi, conservation administrator.
Okay.
My name is Jack Sullivan. I'm owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group. I was not at the first hearing for this project, but based on my client's meeting with the commission, there were a number of items brought up at that hearing that needed to be addressed and added to the plan. And I believe I've done that. Just to recap this project, they're basically looking to add an addition to the front of the house. There'll be a two-story addition with a garage under, and then a portion of the existing single-story home will be converted to a two-story. I provided the existing dimensions of the house. That's more for the building inspector. And the existing deck, I provided the dimensions as well. That's going to look to be retained. What we try to do is there's a number of large pine trees. I know the commission went on a site walk. The ones with X's through them are the ones to be removed. Based on the tree policy for the town, we're showing replacement trees here, 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 to go in the front yard. And I think a majority of the conversation at the last hearing was some of the work that was proposed in the backyard that wasn't shown on the plan. But in an effort to provide some drainage for this property, we are providing a drip trench along the driveway. This hatched area is where the paved driveway will be. Presently, there's a gravel driveway that extends closer to the wetland area, and that area will be loamed and seeded. And there's no work taking place within the 25-foot buffer zone in that area. The two pine trees that will be cut down, we show them to be cut down, but the stumps are to remain. Those two are located within the 25-foot buffer zone, and I think the owner had some discussions with commission members or Chuck on that, but I'm not sure. But we wanted to show those to come down, and we also showed two additional trees to be planted for that. In the rear yard, there's a railroad tie retaining wall, and there's a slope in this area. That railroad tie retaining wall is going to be removed. The rear yard is going to be regraded slightly. It'll be loamed and seeded. There's a 14-inch oak that's close to the tree. It's within the 100-foot buffer zone. It's outside of the 35 to be removed. and we show some four dogwoods to be planted in that general area. We're also showing a portion of the existing, it's lawn basically, that's going to become a mulched area, and there's a, six plantings shown in that area. And if you can pan down a little bit, Chuck. Is it other way, sorry. There's two sheds in the rear yard. One's going to remain. This one will remain. This one will be removed. There's a dead oak tree that I identified, and I showed to be removed as well. The stump will remain, but the tree itself will be taken down. And we tried to call out in the proposed mulch bed area, there'll be low bush blueberry and rhododendron planted. One thing, there's a shed that encroaches onto the abutting property, a small portion's on my client's property. We still note it to be taken down, but we need permission from the abutting owner to do so, since the majority's on the plan. We haven't, I don't think we've had any conversations with the abutter yet to take it down.
No, not to the right, to the left.
And you can see, based on your sidewalk, this property's in need of a lot of repair. Looks like there could be some ledge outcropping in the front area, so that's why it was difficult to do anything with a formal drainage system, such as a dry well, or I looked at trying maybe to do a rain garden or something like that, but when this site slopes off, then we get into an area and we have a high groundwater table, so the drip trench worked best for the driveway. I wanted to provide some drainage mitigation. And I think I'll turn it over to the commission and Chuck for any questions.
When we had a site walk a while ago, I think there was a question about those steel beams that come
yeah.
out of the house on the right, and there's a deck
so,
there.
Yeah.
Did you and the applicant talk to the building inspector?
He did. We did, with, and the proposal is to replace the existing structure due to the it's not built within code. And it's not a safe structure.
Is that the deck and
the deck,
the,
yes.
the I-beams?
Remove the steel beams
yeah.
and put in the large foot columns, 6x6 posts per the deck manual that I have that Glenn had given to me. And he was okay with all that because it's, we're not going to change the dimensions that are there. We're just going to put it back in a safer way, in a code way.
So you're going to put it on sonnet tubes?
Yes, so large foot sonnet tubes.
Yeah, okay.
Big foots.
So those are going to go, I mean, so I guess that's where this question kind of generated from. Those are going to be located, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so I had been talking to Glenn
mm-hmm.
between meetings, trying to figure out if he had gone out to the site or if he had talked about it. Glenn feels very confident about the plan that everyone has, and maybe this is done already, but so first I'll talk about the deck. Glenn has told me that it's actually supposed to be reduced because you're encroaching in a setback, one of the zoning setbacks. You know anything about that, Jack?
I do.
But that's what Glenn had told me. So it's not going to get it built any bigger. It may be built for our purposes. We just need to know how it's built. So you'll be figuring
right,
that
it
out
will, it will not
later
be,
on. Yeah.
Get any larger
than what it
existing.
Is. And possibly it's going to actually move back a little bit.
Yeah.
But it's just typically a deck with footings and support. And it's going to remain open like it is now?
Yes.
With no roof?
Yes, no roof.
The only other question that Glenn had, so that part seems to be solved. The only other question was there some sort of excavation done to understand the depth of the footing to support the second story?
Yes, there was on the very back side, which is right here.
In this area.
Yes, right inside the zone here. We dug down and did find that the footing is not to specification. It's not 4 foot down. So we will need to make an adjustment in the foot in the foundation on that area of the house. Underneath the deck here, there's already retaining. You know, we already have a plan to rebuild the retaining wall to properly support the footings that are already in place there. But this one section, we're going to have to rebuild the foundation in that section.
So you're gonna bring the retaining wall from the side all the way around the back?
No, no, the retaining wall will still end here, and we're just gonna, have to dig down and put a new footing in to help support that end of the house. It's just, unfortunately, I dug down and it's only about 18 inches down.
And just so the commission's clear, was it on the back side as well, and you'll have to do the footing on this side as well, where you're going up the two-story?
That footing is, those footings on that side are submerged by the retaining wall that's in place, and we are rebuilding that retaining wall, yes.
Okay.
It has deteriorated somewhat, so we're gonna need to put it back and, you know, obviously make it look nice and functional again.
In the front, Jack, you said something about you didn't know where the bedrock was. You thought there might be some ledge.
It's like there might be some ledge.
Will you have to blast?
No. If we did, we'd have to go to the fire department. If they, it's a slab on grade garage, so they will need frost wall protection. We don't know right now. If we did have to blast, we'd have to go to the fire department. They typically, it gets expensive to do that. They try to hammer it.
So I guess, explain the footing repairs a little bit to me. So there's going to be more or less excavation all around on the back side, the west side, and where the garage is. Well, the garage is slab. You said just slab on grade.
The garage, yes, will be slab, like you said, slab on grade. Obviously, that will depend on whether or not we do find ledge here. There is some ledge here in the existing basement, so unfortunately, we are afraid that it does extend out, but until we dig, we won't know. And then here is just all backfill anyway, so we're just gonna have to bring it down to the below the frost line and put it in a new footing. Since we are replacing or adding to the structure here, we're gonna take it down to the substructure and just remove it. It's all block wall, so it should be an easy demo anyway. And then,
so I think what we're getting at, you're gonna be able to access that from this side, from the garage side. You're not gonna have to access that from the back side.
I mean, it would be easier to go around if it was possible, that would be okay, but if we have to, yes, we could go through this way. Where this is only a small section, we don't need to send heavy equipment back there. We could use maybe a small bobcat with a skid steer and dig it down.
And you're going to replace that with poured concrete?
Yes.
Put
concrete about 4 foot down for the footing. We'll come up about maybe a foot above grade and then continue up with wood structure.
So you're going to pump that?
Pump, bucket, you know, wheelbarrows.
You're going to wheelbarrow it in, I guess?
If I got a wheelbarrow. I mean, we're not talking about a ton of concrete, but I mean, yeah, it's backbreaking. But
well,
it's
10
a lot
yards
of
concrete.
Yeah, I mean, that's a lot of concrete. Yeah, for.
I'll do what I gotta do. So, because I know I see what you're saying. You probably don't want to bring in big trucks back there. Obviously.
No,
well,
that's the point. You're already in the, you know, where you shouldn't be there.
Right.
Worse, we're trying to mitigate. We're trying to
keep in mind. Did you go to the site visit?
I'll just tell you that
side is rough. It's pretty rough all the way around back. There's always been access with a truck or something like that around the backside.
Really,
that whole
side
is going to need heavy
right up against
landscaping.
The edge of the stream that it becomes kind of natural.
We're not that worried about it.
If he rebuilds it, that's the bonus here.
Okay.
You know, we get lawn in the future.
That's been removed.
All right, good.
Okay.
Short term, yes, it would be a mess. Long term, it will be
okay.
All right,
beautified.
You're removing the existing railroad ties retaining wall in back of the house along the east side.
Yes, that is the east side.
I mean, it's pretty well. It's kind of a slope that goes down to the retaining wall. How are you going to keep that from sloughing off? What are you replacing it with? I mean, it comes down like...
We're just gonna make it a more gradual slope.
So you're gonna grade it down?
Yes. It'll be just like walking uphill when we're done.
So some of the material from the front, when they go to excavate for the garage, will be, they'll take the railroad tie wall out, and they'll use some of that extra fill just to make a gradual slope. So you see I pushed this 116 contour up to here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's some fill going in here to make it more of a gradual slope.
116, 114.
Yeah.
That's not bad.
And are you gonna seed that with grass or?
Yes.
Okay, excuse me. Do I have any other questions from the commission?
I don't have any.
I don't have any other.
Are there any questions from the audience?
Yeah.
Do we have everything we need?
No, I was just going to ask a couple questions from the last meeting. There was talk about more than those, all those trees up front being cut down. You're not doing that anymore?
As far as the more than the ones on the first X, though?
Yeah.
Plan?
Yeah.
Scroll it down.
Sure.
So the original plan had these five, correct? And
yeah.
then we had added about the added these two,
mm-hmm.
and then there was, I believe, some other guests had come and mentioned that there's two rotted ones in the back, and we figured since they're all rotted out, let's get rid of them anyway.
But so that's taking all those huge pines out?
Yes, it turns into, you know, it's a seven pines now, big pines.
And you're able to replace all those with a one-to-one replacement policy?
Yeah, I show seven to be planted.
Okay.
So there's five in this corridor here, and then we put two over here.
So I did write down that I moved around.
Yeah, what are you showing me replaced with them, sir?
Two and a half inch red maples.
Is there a list of plants we can get that you're replacing them with? Is that quick enough that you could just send me that, or is it on the plan somewhere?
It's
kind of on the plan.
It's on the plan, I think.
Yeah, the mulch bed
I'm
right here was for the low bush blueberries, rose
each
bay,
one
rhododendrons.
Is different. Yeah. Okay.
Some dogwoods over there.
Four dogwoods.
And then seven red maples.
So it's kind of where they are.
Six.
It's just where we're going to replace them. Okay. On the plan.
6-7.
That was it.
So are we asking for any more information?
No.
Did we ask for the public? we already did.
Yes, I think I did.
I make a motion to... this is a notice of intent?
Yep.
So what do we do? We're closing them? Closing the meeting?
No,
I'll never
we don't
get this
close.
Right.
We don't close, right, Chuck? Because we still have to look at the order. We have to discuss the order conditions.
Yep.
Yeah, you can... just continue to the next meeting, and I'll have the order of conditions prepared so we can close it that night.
Right.
Or you can close it now, and then I'll prepare it between now and the next meeting, and
decide.
It just means we're not going to get any more input from the applicant or his consultant.
He's given us everything. We're not looking for
no, we're not.
Any more.
So you can close the meeting.
Make a motion to close the meeting.
Yeah.
Second.
All those in favor? Do I hear a motion to issue an order?
No, we're going to write the order first, and then we'll issue it
then we'll
at
issue
the next
it
meeting.
At the next meeting after we sign, before we sign.
Okay. Oh.
Harry, was that you seconding?
Yes.
So we're all set.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
At the next meeting, we'll have it all written. I'll send it to Jack beforehand, and he'll review it.
Well, I'm going to take the truck site next door.
I did. Yep.
Well, that's this. Right?
So, yeah, that was all set.
They just subdivided it.
Yeah, I think it was out in the
back
with everyone.
So
he bought it. Was the house next to the
remember the little footbridge?
Yeah.
He bought
as long as he
inside.
Reviews, we
oh,
wouldn't
okay.
sign off on your building permit until
the
order is
signed.
And then
there's
an appeal period. So you probably
coming
still have about 3 weeks.
Right.
The only other question is, would I have a thumbs up to put in that erosion control before the frost really sets in?
Yep. You can put that in anytime.
Okay.
Okay.
What are you using? Hay bales and silk?
Hay bales and silk.
Sure.
Which is what we proposed.
That's fine.
You don't wanna be staking that one,
No, and that's one of the I actually called the company and they said we're not gonna handle the frost, and I said, oh, geez, I hope I can get it in before the frost sets, so.
They better come tomorrow.
That'll be perfect, yeah.
Yeah, it's gonna be 60 above.
Basically, so, but thank you, I appreciate your time.
Yep.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our 7:30, Roma Lane.
You know, I just mentioned, excuse me, sir, your hay bale comes all the way down into this area.
Yes, it walks the whole property line.
Yeah, I mean, I think you can pretty much stop it right here. I mean, because most of your work is in this area, do you plan on?
With the exception of one tree and one shed coming down.
Yeah, that's you don't need too much control for that.
Okay.
So you can save yourself a little bit of hay bale. Generally in that area, have a few extras on site. When I go out and do my inspection, I might say, you need some more, you don't.
Just a few more, okay.
And usually you wanna keep it right where the work is.
And where the railroad ends.
Something in that,
we'll call
it's far enough away.
Maybe a few feet from the railroad ties.
Yeah, I think the point is this is the close proximity to the work.
Yes.
And that's where we want the protection. I would say about here would be fine.
Okay.
Yeah. Right here where it says silt.
Excellent.
Okay. Right on flag 5E.
Yep. Excellent. Thank you very much.
Okay. Yep.
Okay. Next on the agenda is a continued notice of intent. Hearing for 270-0674 for 44 Aroma Lane, map 50, lot 36, Carroll. And the public meeting is being reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetland Protection Act, Chapter 131, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Applicant will present the proposal. Commission received reports. And the commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and then the public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant. An attendance sheet is in the back corner. Hopefully everybody's signed it. And I'd like to introduce members of the commission starting on my left.
Chuck Tarani, Conservation Administrator.
Michael Flynn.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Al Couillard.
Okay. We had Mr. Carroll here for the last meeting with his consultant from Oxbow Associates. And at that time we had requested that we get a third opinion, but since that time we actually have had conversations with MassDEP. And what I think we'd like to do at this point is to for the record, approve both plans. No?
No. Mm-hmm. No. We just want to mention both plans and I have them on here, so we just want to show the difference of both plans.
Okay.
And I think that that's all we wanted to do. I think the rest of it is up to the, you know, up to the commission, where we did ask for third-party review, and Mr. Carroll said that he does not want to take us up on that offer. So that's where we are, and Mr. Carroll's here to talk about exactly that. So.
So are you putting up both?
Yeah, I'll put up one after another.
What?
I didn't see a plan. Did you already do a sidewalk for this?
Yeah, a while ago.
So why you don't want to go the third party review route?
Yes, I appreciate the offer, but do not. I've only submitted one plan to the commission. I know there is a second one that's been referenced at every subsequent meeting. But I've only filed one.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I believe with the substantiation and findings of Oxbow Associates.
Yep.
And I'm no longer looking to pursue it and looking for the determination from the commission.
So, I mean, though, from where I sit on this, I think whether or not another one has been filed, we know that another applicant, another consultant has been out there, and another line has been shown in the past. We also have done a site visit, and for ourselves, we sit out there, and it seemed like we had a tough time determining. You know, I think that's why we came to the conclusion last time that this was a good option for a third party review.
Right.
You know, I think I'm still of that mindset. You know, I think at this point, and Chuck, I just asked you to confirm, I think there's two routes to go. We have this criteria of either we go the third party review route, or, you know, I think at the applicant's choosing, if he doesn't want to go that route, we can just bypass that and make a decision. I mean, I think there's a decision that would be potentially made by this commission, I think, at that point, right? Is that the process?
We'd deny the plan.
Yep.
For not enough information, it appealed to the state.
Mm-hmm.
And my opinion has a pretty good chance of prevailing at the state. So,
well,
I think what the state says to us, and maybe we can talk to the applicant about this, is I think we're obligated to negotiate the best we can. So I think maybe we could overcome your objection to peer review with a very narrow scope. If, you know, for just the line and keep a very narrow scope, and we kept the peer review to specific areas and a limited amount of funds, I think that would get you to where you want to be faster than a denial and appeal to DEP. I don't know if you're open to that or not, but we have the right to talk about, when we talk about peer review, we have the right, we'll discuss amongst ourselves with you what the peer review is for. And I think that there's a possibility, and I am only one voice, but there's a possibility that this board could keep that to a very narrow scope. So if we can keep it to a narrow scope, only address the main concern, the line, I think we can do it quickly and expensively, and I think it'll get you where you want to go faster than a denial and an appeal. But I guess I'm asking you that question if you're open to that.
So the appeal, just so you know, the appeal isn't just to DEP. He also has to appeal through, so forth, the bylaw.
Well, we don't have a bylaw that says lack of information, do we? What would we say we're
Section
appealing
10
for under our bylaw?
Section 10, if you read the bylaw. It was actually in your packet.
So our denial would say what under the bylaw?
It says we have the right to
ask for third party review.
And if they don't like it, they can go to court.
Doesn't 08-1 say that doesn't matter? They're still gonna
what?
The state will
what is 08?
Still might have. It says that the state still has the right. They don't necessarily have to uphold your bylaw for not enough information.
State
isn't that what it
thing.
Says?
This is so everything that comes into this commission,
yeah,
is reviewed under the Wetlands Protection Act and the Reading Wetlands Protection Bylaw.
Right.
So that line is in dispute under both. Now the state has a process to supersede what we found. And we're saying lack of information, and when the commission was out there, they also had questions on where the line is. So in the past, I've looked through some of these other ones that come from Boxer. The DEP actually comes out and they did this on Cross Street. They actually come out and delineate a line themselves. That would be a great alternative. But usually what ends up happening is they'll accept it or they'll uphold it. Let's say they issue a superseding order. He's still left with dealing with Redding's bylaw, which will prevent him from building.
Have you investigated this?
Yes.
You know what that means? That means Superior Court?
Yes.
A couple of years, 2.5 years and $5,000 or $8,000.
Yeah, I'm not thrilled about it either.
I just want to make sure you know, that's all.
Yeah.
As long as you know.
Yeah. Full transparency, certainly not my first choice.
Well, let's work together, try and get a narrow scope and get a line and.
The last meeting, Harry, you brought up a great point of bringing in the third party, and I can certainly understand and appreciate bringing in another party to validate it. My biggest concern and issue throughout this whole process is that I feel as though that original manual line that I never submitted has clouded everyone's opinion of the current state of the property. Had that not been shown to the commission, last commission and currently, I feel as though the direction of this with my findings that I had with Oxbow would be very different. And unfortunately, that's how I feel, and it's my opinion, and I realize this.
Sir, you might feel that, but I was out there, and we saw vegetation. Yes, so the trees appeared more upland, but there were also shrub species in that area. To the left of your house in that kind of a lower area that are indicative of a wetland, a high bush blueberry. And when Brian Butler did some cores throughout that area, some were up, some were very hydric, you know, and I'm not real great with my soils, but it was very, very obvious to me, you know, down close to the stone wall, but also quite a ways up towards Roma Lane.
And again, and in all fairness and to be impartial, yeah, I can certainly understand that opinion. Overall, I think it's very gray of whether this area is classified as wetlands or not. And if it's gray and if it's a, quote unquote, for lack of a better terms, a coin flip, I don't understand what's at stake in preventing of what my gains for my residential property.
Well, I think what you just said is why I would want a third-party review. I think it's very clear that this is a gray area, that it's unclear if it is a wetland or not. And so that's the idea of the third-party review, for someone to come in and give a second opinion, an independent opinion, to say, this is where I think the line is. And so that is...
Would this board be comfortable with a peer review that would...
Just to align.
To set the line?
That's what we said last time.
That's, I'm going to estimate, and you can't hold me to this, but I'm guessing maybe $1,500. We could probably get a consultant in that neighborhood to do a line like that, Chuck, in that neighborhood.
We could work with someone and probably be there under. I mean, please don't hold us to this, but.
Yeah, I mean,
there's a variance between, it could be 500, it could be 1500, depending on what we ask for and deliverables.
So would this board be comfortable with peer review just for that line on a very narrow scope?
That's what we said last time.
Are you okay with that?
I feel as though that's just a third party review.
It is. It is 30-party review with a narrow scope, but that's your best plan of attack right now. You can do whatever you want, but other than that, you're going to be tied up in court for years.
But again, not to get caught up in semantics.
Well, if you think you're right and you want to stand your ground, that's fine with us. I just want to make sure you know your options.
I mean,
we're willing to do a narrow scope. If you're not willing to do that, in all likelihood, again, I'm only one vote, this project is going to be denied. And then you're going to have to do your thing on your end.
It's not a project. It's
the.
It's an ANRAD.
The ANRAD.
It's an ANRAD.
It's going to be denied.
Correct. So what is the process? Explain to me the process and timeline of that.
I gave that to you, and it's outlined there.
Okay. Is it?
No.
Is it?
So the applicant shall pay the fee to be put into a revolving fund, which may be drawn upon by the commission for specific consultant services approved by the commission at one of its public meetings. The consultant shall be chosen by and report only to the commission or its designee. That's the process is before that. we would get several, and you could suggest people, we would get several consultants to give us a bid on that project. And we're obligated to pick the lowest that we feel the most confidence with, okay? And so I think everyone on the list would be at a high level, you know, of confidence anyways, but they're gonna come in different bids. And so that's the first step. And then we would tell you that we found three people, we would send you them just to review. The commission would pick which one they want to use, and then whatever that bid is that consultant wanted would be paid by you, put into that revolving fund, and then when he's done, we would pay him his fees, and we would have the answer, which apparently is going to be $1,500 instead of 2 years and $8,000. There's two lines out there, and
why are there two lines out there?
Well, but the one thing, and I know you're focusing on the manual line, but the commission went out there too and had some questions. So there's really, if we were hanging flags ourselves, we walked past the Oxbow line. I think what you want to do is you want to have your project and you want to have a line, and we want to have a line because, you know, for us to somehow look the other way and allow you to work in the wetlands doesn't work for our whole process here.
Sure.
And for you, the best thing to do is to know where that line is and make sure it's accurate, and then you could move on, you know? So that's what Al's saying. He has a good background in situations like this, so he's probably fought it a few times too, but I think the best thing to do would, from what I'm hearing, is to come up with a situation that we both can enter into and get the results we want.
I'm not comfortable at this point bringing a third party in for a third line.
Okay.
But we're uncomfortable with
I understand
the area.
Does a third become a fourth? Does a fourth become a fifth?
No. No, actually it wouldn't. I mean, it would be that third party review, whether it was or it wasn't, and
correct.
Then we would concur with that professional opinion. We just couldn't feel real confident that out there. Something is kind of odd going on out there. Now maybe it's some kind of drainage that, I don't know, that happened with the development of Roma Lane. I don't know. I just can't answer that. But I did see some evidence of things that are questionable in the area, just to the left of the house.
So, I mean, it sounds like the applicant is fairly confident in the way he wants to go. I guess, Chuck, what's the process for the denial? What ends up getting submitted to DEP with this?
So there's two things you can do. You actually can write your findings down and, you know, kind of portray what went on here, which is the best way to do it.
Yeah.
And then you just put denial on the order of conditions, and then the applicant has 10 days to appeal that, and he has 60 days to appeal it in Superior Court.
This is not intent. Chuck, this is not a notice of intent.
No, it's an ANRAD.
Right.
But for all intents and purposes, it would be handled the same way.
Okay.
It's just on the agenda.
It's on the agenda again as a notice of intent.
No.
So it would be appealed, it would be a denial of the ANRAD, correct?
Right. Just for lack of information.
Sufficient information
right.
to make a decision
we have
on
some,
the line.
Sounds like we have some findings. Chuck, if I don't mind helping you out, can we get something together for to get it together?
We have 20, we have the same 21 days to
submit the findings.
So if you can close tonight, we still have those 21 days to issue, and then, you know, so during that time we could do that.
Okay.
So you know, I wasn't so sure. I mean, are you sure you wanna, or do you wanna think about it a little bit more?
No, unfortunately, this has been 4 years, you know, in the making. I mean, it needs to end. So, I'm looking for a determination tonight.
Okay. So I make a motion to. Ooh, do you need to ask for public?
Yeah. Are there any questions from the audience? Okay. Hearing none.
I make a motion to close the meeting. It's ANRAD for 44 Roma Lane, 270674.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Chuck, for the next meeting, can you put together, we can give you some language, put together some findings, and
sure.
We'll, at that point, we make a vote on the
ORAD.
A denial.
Okay. So we won't be taking any more information about this application, and I'll write a denial. Between the two meetings, the commission will discuss it at the next meeting, and vote on it, up or down. So that's it.
Terrific.
All right, thank you, Matt.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right.
So Becky, can you just for the record, we've talked about both plans here. The manual plan and the other plan, so.
You gotta know when to hold them and know when to fold them.
Close. So, we've
are we adding one to the record? Are we supposed to?
It's part of our findings. We can.
Didn't we just vote for denial to
No, we voted to close the meeting.
No, we still.
So similar to how we put together an order of conditions.
Next week we're
next
gonna
meeting
vote for the
we'll
final
have a,
denial
have
the
some findings
to
put together. With that, we'll sign and vote on a.
Okay. Well, the manual plan will be referenced in the findings.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. All right. And that's it for that particular project.
Yeah, all right. I think we're on to the next.
Yeah, we're on to the next one.
Okay. We have a continue. Notice of intent for 364 Lowell Street, which has been continued at the request of the applicant. And also the 750 notice of intent for Low Meadow, 270-0676, has also asked to be continued until January 25th at the applicant's request. And now we're on to old and new business, and we have Randall Road Extension 270-0673, Order of Conditions, which you folks have reviewed.
Did you see the bond?
Anyone else want to review this?
Oh, is it right there?
Yeah.
I was just trying to look at it.
So we can take a few minutes to review it, and anybody else, I can put it on my iPad if you want.
Sorry, I didn't have a chance. I saw you send it out today.
Yeah,
I
read it on my phone during the meeting.
Anybody else? Becky?
I took a look at it before the meeting. And Harry had some minor comments. Edits.
He did. God bless Harry.
Harry used to be an English teacher in his past life.
My daughter's an English major.
Oh, there you go.
My mother was a geography teacher.
I'm going to start learning English as a second language.
It's reminiscence of the old days when Jamie would read.
You couldn't email it beforehand?
What?
When you couldn't email it beforehand?
No, we'd get it that night. Spend a lot of time reviewing it.
Go through each bullet point one by one out loud?
No. I don't believe we ever did that.
Mike is my best reviewer. Give him a few minutes.
Yes.
So why is Anika at the budget meeting? What's she trying to find out?
No, I think it's just a general meeting.
Yeah.
I thought it was a budget meeting.
It is the budget meeting, but it's not really to for us to ask for things, but it's for us to be there in case a question comes up. We have representation to answer those questions. So that's our role.
Anika wasn't authorized to ask for a raise for you.
I'll be happy just to
keep your job, right?
Yeah. Well, you know, I think that, you know, when I got in Reading, it was, we had a lot of great projects here. I think that wherever you work, it takes a long time to build a team, and I think we have a great team here now. And I think that with the planning, engineering, zoning, building, everyone's working better and better and better together. So I know I can't wait for, you know, you to come through again and tell us if it is smoother or not. So I mean, that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to make it.
I'm working on it.
Yeah, making it work for everybody and still, you know, staying in tune with our regulations.
I'm fine with this. Do we need to make a motion?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was, you need to, why don't you close the hearing
do I have issue. A motion to close the hearing?
Make a motion to close the hearing on Randall Road Extension.
I'll second.
All those in favor?
I'll make a motion to approve the order of conditions as amended by Harry's
very minuscule typos.
Small changes.
I second.
All those in favor?
It wasn't what he said, it was the way he said it.
Well, he didn't like the all caps.
No, so I loved it. I loved it. I thought it was really funny.
Well, the irony is I read over the last 2 days at work 160 pages of bank training materials. And had to provide line by line feedback on change this to that and this to that and this to that. So by comparison,
this was easy. That was good.
An exciting reading.
So the last time I was in Superior Court, it was actually 5 years in Superior Court on an appeal. They did not do anything quickly. In Superior Court, the judge isn't a wetlands judge. He's a Superior Court judge.
Oh, yeah,
doesn't know anything about wetlands. Normally,
they're not looking for that. It's town council has to write a brief.
Right.
So he's just, you know, will be needed to, put all the information out there. But then they put it together. It's pretty much 30 hours worth of work.
It's a lot of work, a lot of time, a lot of energy for what he.
But I do appreciate that offer. That was good.
What offer?
You're trying to talk him down from the ledge.
Yeah, I mean, he's crazy. Not crazy, but I mean,
I feel bad, actually.
Yeah, I do. The shortest route for what he wants to do was you know, a narrow scope on a peer review.
If a consultant came and said it's not a wetland, that the third, we would concur with it. I mean, that would be a professional opinion, which has no skin in the game, and
he could live with the ANRAD,
yeah,
and adjust his work accordingly, no matter what it is. I mean,
right.
That doesn't make sense, but whatever. I think he feels he's standing on principle because he never gave anybody that first line, which, you know, you can't put genie back in the bottle. We saw it too late. What are you gonna do?
So he's also the same guy that had, you know, had Brad Jones try to.
Yeah, he worked in some angles on top of everything else.
Okay, we have a determination of applicability, 2016-17, 23 Smith Ave.
Smith Ave.
Mr. Coleman.
Can we get a copy of that order of conditions if I come up to your office, say, sometime?
Yes. All right.
And is it written in a language that we would understand?
No.
It's to help you, to
that,
your favorite.
That we can't help you with. But you set yourself
English
up for that.
Be good.
It is.
You probably could just wait till you have a book and page, right, Chuck? Send them the book and page.
Can yeah, you could do that, but
until it's mailed to the applicant.
Right.
And I think that I'm going to mail it out tomorrow, so anytime after Tuesday of next week, I think that would be fine.
So
you know, he should get it first, right?
Hmm?
The applicant.
Well, yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
he's got to comply with it.
Yeah. Come on in
yes.
after that, and I can even email it to you. I have your email. So.
Oh yeah, email would be perfect.
Sure.
I'll email it to you. You know what, Mr. Coleman, review it, and if you have any questions.
I probably won't understand it, but I know the neighbors will ask me, well, what does it say? I don't know. They said they like it. They approved it. I just have one question that isn't pertinent to just tonight, but just to this whole process. We've got a plan now, and it's got a replicated wetland. This is going to be moved. My question is, who determines that the replication worked, that it's truly a wetland, and when do they do this, and for how long? And if it turns out it's not performing as a wetland, or meets the criteria of a wetland, who rectifies it, and thirdly, at whose expense?
It's reviewed, I think it's reviewed every first 3 years, and it has
just two,
and it has to have viable vegetation.
They said 80% viability, and we said 80% viable
plants. They have to survive
2 years.
And we get
bond.
We get monitoring reports on, you know, somebody goes out and monitors that.
Well,
who
does that?
In this case, it will be Norris Environmental. They'll
okay.
go out and do that.
And
so a written report shall be sent to the commission biannually by the 10th of January and by the 10th of July, documenting, inspecting, cleaning, blah, 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 all this. So we'll have a report for the wetland once a year, but for some of the drain systems and other than that, twice a year. So.
And if the plants are dead, if more than 20% are dead, they have to replace them with new plants.
So, but in the past, during the order of conditions, we replace all the plants. All right. So if they're dying, so if he's building there and he gets it done in a year, and during that year, three or four plants die before he gets his occupancy, he's replanting those plants. We're going to have 100% planted, alive plants. When they get their occupancy.
So we're not talking about wild plants like skunk cabbage. We're talking about things that.
No, what he's planted.
Okay.
That's what he is responsible for.
So if, say, after 2 or 3 years, everything's dead, it's not really a wetland, what happens? Does that have to be rebuilt?
Well, where it's built, it should have the rest of the wetland should, you know, take over. I mean, they're digging it out. It's going to be low, so it's going to have the water, and it's going to have the seed bank from what's around it. So volunteer vegetation will probably come in, even though he's planting other things.
I was just curious, because I think it's easy to make rules, but then you people have processed so many applications over the years in this town, I'm thinking, who the hell follows through on all of this stuff? Who sees, you know, that the rules are being followed?
Chuck's a busy guy.
Chuck's a really busy guy.
That's why Anik is trying to get his pay raise right now.
I'll tell you, there's a bunch of people all around town that take it real seriously.
Yeah.
And we don't try to make it a burden, but, you know, the way I feel is that it's like a deal that we're making here. And we allow them certain latitude for them to do things for us. So if I gave up on the plants or an amount of space or something like that, that's like breaking the deal, and no one wants that. So that should survive. And I even think if they forget about it, it's just going to fill in with, you know, like I said, the volunteer vegetation in that area.
Yep.
That's a pretty high tech
stormwater system you have there. And it's gonna be interesting, because it's taking out the phosphorus too. So it's gonna be...
And isn't that system maintained by the company?
Company's gonna maintain it or guarantee that it works for 2 years.
The town's supposed to clean it.
Who is the company?
Not for 2 years.
The contractor?
So the company, Filtrex?
Yeah, I think you're right.
Filtrex will have a contractor here and do maintenance on those trees and that system for 2 years. And then after that, the town will take it over. And what I'm hearing from the town engineer is that with the new MS4 permits, that they need to have more of these around town. So it's just something that they are going to have to do.
Can I ask a question? I don't know if it's related or unrelated. We have that drainage easement in the back of where they're gonna do the works in back of our property.
And your name is?
Gretchen Baker.
And where do you?
62 Glenmere.
Thank you.
So these two houses,
sorry.
Yep.
Who's supposed to maintain that drainage easement that runs in the back of our house? Because I know it's our land, but it's wetlands, so we're not supposed to do anything with it. But like when trees fall in it, and rocks fall in it, and it can't drain anymore because there's so much stuff in there.
Is it a town drainage easement?
It was,
yeah.
An easement to the town of Reading?
Yeah.
So
built
the town,
by the town, and yeah.
The Army Corps of Engineers built it.
So the town is, in the past they had a group called the Highway Crew, and they would do all this work. But now with all the cuts that have gone on, and even before my time, they weren't even here. So there's no one here.
I've never seen anyone clean it, so.
Well,
the DPW?
Most of these things work. You know how these things work? It's by calling up and saying there's a problem.
Yeah.
And identifying the problem. But where you're talking about has pretty steep banks. So it's probably somebody downstream who's saying, I'm getting flooded, and they have to do something about it.
That's exactly what it was.
Well, I mean,
people down the street were,
I don't know if we're supposed to go out there, but we do it every year on us. You know, pull rocks out because they roll down the hill into the ditch. And then the water can't go anywhere. Pull trees out when they fall over.
Bumpers.
Yeah, car bumpers. You can't even imagine. So I just wasn't sure if we were supposed to do that. Or
you're probably doing a pretty good job.
Yeah,
because I think
that.
To
hear that, actually.
Yeah, I'm really happy that you're.
Nobody else does it, but we do it.
Yeah. So no, it's wonderful that you're trying to prevent flooding. I know the town is taxed by just trying to get out to many places, and there's a lot more.
I just want to keep the mosquitoes down.
Oh my!
When the water backs up,
yes.
Then yeah.
I'm telling you. I was gonna say, I'll send you those plans.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Yeah.
Good night.
There's another meeting with the CBDC on this, I think. Or
we don't really know how.
I think they continue.
He's pretty much through the
problem, but I don't.
He's pretty much through the process. There might be another meeting or two, but they're good to go with the commission and probably pretty close with everyone else.
Yeah, we went out there today and kind of looked at the backyard and said, well, this is the last time it'll look like this.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Which one is this? 23 Scott Street.
23
Smith Street.
I don't know what that is.
What project is this?
Is that behind the water company? Electric company?
I'm trying to remember, too.
So we went out there, 23 Smith Street, and they're doing an addition. It was a Jack Sullivan applicant, but Jack wasn't here, and Mrs.
Yes, I know,
what's
and
her
I do.
Name?
Yeah,
Smith?
I do.
No.
Brett?
Mrs. Brett gave the presentation and
did
a really
good
job at it.
You're right, she did
so,
a good job.
yeah, it was good. I think Jack's got some competition. So anyways, you closed it, and I wrote the order. And
we asked her to...
And it's in there too.
And
she said
debris.
She'd be delighted to do that.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, last meeting. Right.
Yeah, just
okay.
At the very last meeting, right.
Now I remember her.
I mean, the distances are pretty far, so it really wasn't a big deal. But they are doing infiltration, and they're going to remove some of that debris, and they'll probably stop dumping it in back there.
So I was pretty surprised. I'm pretty shocked that it's going to cost about $1,000 to put up 6 bathhouses.
Yeah, that's a expensive.
Well, he's buying kits. He's not making them.
Yeah, those
so
look.
It just seems like an awful lot of money for a galvanized steel pole in a box.
I think you just found a business there.
Yeah. I've always
you can undercut.
Well, when you know, scout project also involves lunch. Yeah. You know? So he's probably going to have his buddies out there and you know. So.
You know, it's a great project.
Yeah, he talked to us in the office, and he really did a lot of research. He wants to
he
be
good
an environmental
answers.
He had really good answers.
Yeah.
Why are you painting it?
No,
it
in that, you've got to have a warm environment, and you kind of have to have it facing south.
We actually discussed it, the last scout that did this. We actually discussed different, tones of black and which is better. Was it more of a brownish black or a black? That kid and the other kid knew more about what colors he was trying to go for.
Although I had to laugh, he's going to use 2 gallons of paint on six bat houses. You might want to start.
Well,
with
he has a mentor. I'm sure that. Maybe he hasn't painted any houses, but that other guy must have. So, I guess first and foremost, if there's a few things that I need to talk about.
Well, wait a minute. What about...
We've got one more thing, right?
Artists?
Yeah, and that's... We haven't got anything from
right.
Them.
Oh, okay.
No.
Oh,
okay. And then... so it's the annual report time.
Oh, you had such good help on this last year.
I had no help last year.
Oh, wait.
Yeah. They're not asking for a lot. But they're asking for a little bit, you know, like who's on the commission and some of the things that we were proud of that we did and
I'll
all
take
that.
The who's on the commission section.
I'll do the tree
That's
policy.
Usually what I do.
But
why don't we...
We talked about... we were reminiscing, fondly reminiscing about all of our projects. And the first one that came in January that was really hot and heavy was Randall Road.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And here we are.
Well, there's a section where you write down all the projects that came through and a little bit about them. If someone wants to be the lead, I can send it to that person to kind of get a rough draft, and then we can just fill in the rest.
Yeah, I'll do that. I've got some time.
Okay. I'll do that tomorrow, and then I guess we'll just send it around. And this is not a next meeting thing. This is a next Friday thing, okay?
Oh, it's coming up that quickly, huh?
Well,
oh, no, not again.
Yeah. I mean, if you just do a little bit, I can do some. And
I think I can do some tomorrow, actually.
We have all of next week. Plus, I hear that it's going to be hard walking out to Princeton, Mass.
What do you mean?
So maybe you're going to stay home and work on the port report. MACC has its conference, March 4th, 2017. I just received a list of classes and workshops, and I will scan that and send it out to the commission. This is something that we pay for. It's an all-day event, but you don't have to go all day. You can just do the morning classes or you can do the afternoon classes. But it's always good to go. It gets you, you can meet different people.
It's kind of the theme this year, Chuck. Is there anything
wetlands.
Yeah, it's a wetland, wetland theme.
No. Wasn't it open space last year?
It didn't feel that way. Last year was,
yeah.
A lot of it was how to run a meeting, how to get home before midnight. Those kinds of things.
Well, those are their
standard
classes.
Yeah,
so we didn't adhere to any of that.
Pass that around.
We didn't adhere to any of that.
Only nine.
Actually, we got 3 hours. We can fill that up.
Cold water fisheries, proposed wetlands protection regulation amendments, protecting Massachusetts vernal pools.
Oh, these aren't the classes.
Habitats of high effective conservation. Habits of a highly effective conservation commission. These are the Series A workshop, making maps simple, U.S. Army Corps engineer regulations, jurisdiction, mitigation, all that, solar arrays.
Speaking of, Chuck.
Here's something that we need, commissions behaving badly. lessons in legal liability.
You did a role play of that last year.
Did you do that?
I was the
bad.
I was the consultant, and my cousin was on the commission, and like my brother was the applicant or something, and we had to try really
approved.
Hard to not laugh. It was pretty funny.
Yeah, here's one that might be interesting with the Lakeview project construction impacts. What applicants won't tell you about their redevelopment site. So riverfront and redevelopment is pretty much what that is. Wildlife assessment, I mean, those are okay. Floodplains.
And there's a series of
anything on that?
Things that you're supposed
that
to take in order
just,
to be a commissioner, right? Is this like a certification?
Oh, this is just
there?
A sign up.
I thought there was a series that we were supposed to
it
do.
It seemed to. There is a series. There's
you
the.
Could do that.
There's
yeah.
the.
Look at her rolling her eyes at me. Trying to be a good dude.
Oh, what do they call
you
the workshops?
You want to go to all of those? Yeah. Well.
I enjoyed it last year.
Fundamentals for conservation commissioners. I did all those, like in a year and a half.
Yeah.
I was going everywhere when I did that. Down the Cape, Western Mass. I was like insane about it. Yeah, starts at 8, there's an exhibit hall, there's a lot of stuff. I mean, I think you'd get a lot out of it. You might.
Are there cocktails?
No.
Yeah.
Yes.
What's that?
That's incorrect. There are cocktails.
Really?
Yeah, at the end, I'll tell you, right here.
Fairy shrimp martini.
That's a
very nice.
That's a
right at the end. President's reception is.
Maybe some cocktails before. If that would get you
before,
get you through
I think
it.
I
didn't come
beer.
Up with that one. Did you hear that?
Fairy shrimp martini.
He's like,
so I'll send that out again to the commission. But you know, we all should go because it gets you, you know, juiced up and, you know,
get you juiced.
Sometimes it's harder to sit down and read the book and really get a sense of. I mean, every time you're gonna pick up something. Some people who just, you know, are newer are gonna pick up a lot. But it's an opportunity to ask questions from experts. And all those things that you can say, hey, Chuck said this, and I've never agreed with him. What do you think about that?
God, I'd be there 3 days.
Yeah?
Chuck,
there you
the
go.
Way.
Well, then you're going to have your money's worth, or my money's worth.
Thank you for reaching out to Eugene. I thought that was really helpful.
Okay, so 22 Pasture Road is submitted a request to have a minor plan change.
Pasture Road.
Where is it?
Which one is what that?
Is that the one with the famous swale?
Yes. Yeah,
the one with the pool, and the weird
yeah.
swale,
mm-hmm.
and the wetland.
The wetland, that's not a wetland.
To the marsh. What,
long
what
and short of it is.
What do you call that?
What's that?
What do you actually do you call that next door?
Kind of a wet meadow is what you'd call it.
What do you call it?
Squishy lawn.
I call
nothing.
It grass. It should be,
it
should be
wet
lawn.
Grass.
It should be lawn.
That that's came in while I was here. Anika was the only one on the agenda. The guy asked that he could mow it more often because it was more expensive to mow it when it was higher grass. And the commission that sat at that time really had some strong opinions about what that was and the bargaining and how that house was put there. And there was some give and take, and it wasn't, hey, build the house and then later on get this front lawn again. It was, no, if you want to build that house, this is going to be a wet meadow, and that was the agreement that was made. So anyways, that's my take on.
So the commission back then said no, and he mowed it anyways because it's grass now.
It's supposed to be mowed
once a year, twice a year,
something like that. So, and he seemed to be doing what he was supposed to be doing. He was saying
like
that
it
was just too expensive. So, his next door neighbor presented a plan, and the scope was just a little bit bigger. So, the old house was, the old addition was 26 by 50 along the back, you know, give or take. It's not 50, it's like boxes, but generally 50 feet wide, 26 deep. And now it's 18 by 50, and it's got a 16 by 12 deck on it, so it's probably 20 by 50 now.
By 50?
Am I saying, I think it's 50. Well, I'm assuming it's the same width. 20 and 18, that's 40, 38. So it's 20 by 38 is the new size. So he's reducing it and he's asking for a minor plan change. So I think you should support this minor plan change and approve it.
Make the motion to approve the minor plan change at
22 Pasture.
22 Pasture.
Second.
All those in favor?
And that's hopefully all I have. But oh, let me make sure this is him.
How is my coconut logs at Perfecto's going?
Did they cut those trees down?
I don't think they never called me, and they, so they're putting it off until the spring, in my opinion.
They also
There's a coconut log. There's a coconut log installation workshop on the MACC conference.
I think you should go.
We should go.
There you go.
So coconut. So is he going to be looking for occupancy for that? That building looks.
They don't
painted
get it
interior
until
walls.
We're satisfied.
They got a long ways to go before.
They should.
I mean,
do.
Have
this
you looked,
is really slow.
Have you looked inside? I don't think
anywhere
close
inside,
to
just
occupancy.
Just driving by.
Yeah.
When you drive by, it looks empty inside.
It is.
They haven't built in inside at all.
Oh really? Okay.
I think this is a kind of inching
more
along.
More a hobby than a
yeah
commercial enterprise.
Yeah. They've got a project.
Is that a franchise? I thought that was a franchise. Perfectos.
Yeah, the guy that came in is, from what I understand, is the guy that started it. There's several of them, but other people in his family own certain spinoffs, which is, has the same name. So he might own, there were 7 stores, he might own 4. And someone else owns 2, and someone else owns, but they're all the same family.
Okay. Because usually a franchise wouldn't put up with that nonsense, but. Sounds like it's a little different.
Sounds like family.
It's
business.
A family business.
So, you got a bad bagel one day, didn't you?
I go to Bagel World, not Perfecto. I like my bagels with rats in them.
We just had bagels from Bagel World.
I love those bagels.
Left over from some sort of meeting. They were pretty good.
They're good bagels.
Really?
Yeah,
yeah
they're
really
good.
Really?
You don't like them?
You don't like
I don't like bagels around here.
Oh, these are not. These are relative to around here.
I like New Jersey
yeah,
deli bagels.
What's the difference? What do you like about them? Crispy? On the outside?
They're just good. They're just good. They really are. I mean, and I wouldn't even bother.
Thanks for
these.
I taking
I
the time to
say the same
that.
Thing. These, I think Bagel World is does a pretty good job.
I do too.
I wish they maintained that place though, like.
I just wish they could move.
Just close your eyes. Go through the drive-through. You don't have to see anything.
Oh, the traffic.
Everyone goes through the drive-through. That's the whole problem.
Are we ready to adjourn?
Just before
no,
we do
I,
this,
well,
can we, you continue on, and I'm going to just make sure.
Where's what time is this budget meeting supposed to get over?
I'm sorry.
Isn't Nika supposed to come back with something, some news for us?
I would assume that she was done now.
No, she left her stuff here.
We can leave it with Chuck and...
Is that yours?
Oh, no, she left her stuff here.
I don't think...
Okay.
I don't think we need to stay for the report, do we?
You do. We're going to... Why don't we all take
I'll
a vote?
Deputize
I'll
I make a motion.
Go get me a bagel and I'll stay.
You know. Yeah. All right.
So...
Killing a little bit of time. I don't know if there's much of it.
What's the deal with? Oh, that is Lowell Street. Huh? No. What's the retaining wall one?
Kylie Drive.
Oh,
Salem.
318, 218 Salem Street.
Oh.
Yes.
They're just closed down for the winter. They did end up recording their certificate of their order of conditions, so we released the enforcement order. That was the last step we took. Tom Hughes is the consultant on that project, and just give him a call in the spring and see what's at.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I'm sure that, I mean, the place looks, you know, vegetated and so I'm not worried about erosion or anything like that. I just want to make sure the fences go up where they're supposed to go and we don't forget about that. Well, no one forgets about that.
God, what?
Is there anything specific on Acadia, Loveno?
Nothing came up with that because they, at the last meeting, they continued a couple of meetings. We needed some information, which we didn't get. So we're still waiting for that information.
We need a lot of information, though. We had a lot of feedback.
Yeah, we got something from DEP, which I put in the packets, just saying that they thought that there was a lot more land around the house than was needed to maintain the house. And I found
wait,
that...
Wait, I didn't see that in the packet. What was this?
So I called DEP.
Yeah.
And talked to them.
Okay.
Gary Boat.
You got through.
Yeah. And actually, I just left a voicemail when he called me back. I was so sorry for him. Anyway, I just wanted to get a second opinion of how I was looking at things. And so I didn't hear much new, but then I think they went in and did a review. So I don't know, I think my phone call may have precipitated them taking a closer look at it. And they said, basically, this project isn't in compliance because the lawn should only be, the yard should, the clearing should only be enough to give you room to build a house. Basically, it doesn't give you any right to put up any yard. And you can't have a garage.
Oh, I did see that.
Which I didn't quite understand. So is a garage technically not part of a single family home? Is that the idea?
I think in a radical right-wing definition.
I'm gonna put on Al's cap for a second. DEP is only giving suggestions. So it's up to us. It's not like they're not allowed.
No, I get that. I get that.
You know how I feel. We give them a house and 2.5 feet of yard, and we're going to be back there every year for the next 20 years.
I know. That's
live with what we'll accept now.
Right.
Find a compromise.
Right.
I mean, the only
give him something
area
to
of
deal
lawn
with, and then we can be really pissed off if he violates.
You know, on that one side. I mean, certainly I wanted to know where the sheet flow was going off the driveway. So that was grading, which we didn't, you know, I'd like to see not spot grades, but grading on the driveway to make sure it flows where we want to. And then I asked the engineering department, what do you do about, you know, water coming off a driveway from, you know, from this place? And says it's up to them. They'll approve it or they'll ask them to do something about it. But they didn't review it yet. So, I mean, again, you know, Al has more experience with that. I don't know. Did you ever look, what did you think of the driveway?
I didn't really look at it.
He was in Florida.
Yeah. Steep driveway spilling out onto a road.
Well, just put a drain in it. Put a 2 foot by 2 foot and put it into a Caltech.
Jesus Christ.
Underneath the driveway, that's fine. I've been forced to do that a handful of times in other communities.
So she's not answering her phone?
I thought I should have called in, but I just emailed a landline, so I don't know.
The smartphone's not so smart.
Let's see what's going on.
What do you have for her for a mobile?
We're still on TV.
You can write it down and
yeah, just
it over.
Come on over here.
Yeah, we should. Why don't we adjourn so they turn the TV off?
She sent me an email. She said, if you finish the meeting before I get back, I can pick up my stuff tomorrow at town hall.
Okay. Do I hear a motion to adjourn the meeting?
Make a motion to adjourn.
Second motion to adjourn.
All those in favor?